Stand to, said Cydrex, and I returned my attention to the army before us. They'll come at us now, a big wave to test us. I looked back at the Shreemans, who now came at us in a run. Arrows flashed from the lines of archers ranged before us, and scores of enemy warriors died. Bronze plate and shields saved some, but the range was so close that many fell with shafts punched clean through their breastplates. Another volley hammered the Shreemans, swiftly followed by another. Hundreds were down. Their line was wrecked and disorganized. Now, roared Cydrex, into them! Our infantry surged forward in a wedge, spears lowering as they charged. I was carried by the mass of men behind me, managing to drag my blade from its shed as I ran. I screamed to keep my fear at bay, worrying that I might trip on my scabbard. I saw the faces of the Shreemans, the braids in their hair, the gold of their crests, and the blood smearing their tunics. We were so close, I could have whispered and they might have heard me. We struck their wavering ranks like a thunderbolt. Spears thrust and shivered, hafts splintering the impact. Driven by sheer will and 1,000 years of pent-up anger, the momentum of our charge clove deep into their ranks, splitting them and breaking their formation completely. Anger gave me strength, and I swung my sword. It bit into flesh, and blood sprayed me. I heard screaming. It might have been me. I can't say for sure. I tried to stay close to Cydrex and Colgrim, knowing that where they fought, Shreemans would be dying. I saw Cydrex felling men by the dozen with his huge pole arm, but could no longer see Colgrim. I soon lost sight of Cydrex in the heave and sway of surging warriors. I called his name, but my shout was drowned in the roar of battle. Bodies slammed into me, pulling at me, clawing my face. Icathian hands or Shreeman, I had no idea. A spear stabbed towards my heart, but the tip slid from my breastplate to slice across my arm. I remember pain, but little else. I hammered my sword into a screaming man's face. He fell and I pushed on, made fearless by fear and savage joy. I roared and swung my sword like a madman. Skill was meaningless. I was a butcher hacking meat. I saw a man die whose skill was much greater than mine. I kept moving, lost in the swirling tide of flesh and bone. Whenever I saw an exposed neck or back, I struck. I took grim pleasure in my killing. Whatever the outcome of this day, I could hold my head high in the company of warriors. More arrows flew overhead, and the cheers rising from our army were songs of freedom. And then the Shreemans broke. It began as a single slave warrior turning his back and running. But his panic spread like fire on the plain, and soon the whole formation was streaming back down the hill. In the days leading up to this moment, Cydrex had told me that the most dangerous moment for any warrior is when a regiment breaks. That is when the killing truly begins. We tore through the routed Shreemans, spears plunging into exposed backs and axes splitting skulls. They were no longer fighting back, simply trampling one another to escape. The bloodshed was appalling, yet I reveled in it as hundreds of bodies were crushed in the slaughter. I saw Cydrex again, then standing firm, his pole arm at his side. Hold! He yelled. Hold! I wanted to curse his timidity. Our blood was up and the Shreemans were fleeing in panic. I did not know it at the time, but Cydrex had seen how dangerous our position truly was. Pull back! He shouted, and the cry was taken up by others who saw what he had seen. At first it seemed our army would not heed his words, drunk on victory and eager to plunge onward. We were intended on slaying every one of the enemy, wreaking vengeance upon soldiers who had held our land hostage for centuries. I had not seen the danger, but all too soon I understood. Screams and fountains of blood sheeted from the leading edges of our battle line. Severed heads flew backwards, spinning like rocks skipped over a pool. Bodies soon followed, tossed aside without effort. Screams and cries of terror erupted, and the songs of freedom were snuffed out. The God Warriors had entered the fray. Three of them surged into our ranks, some moving like men, others like ravenous beasts. Each was armed with a weapon larger than any man could lift, unstoppable and invincible. They raided through our ranks, with sweeping blows that slew a dozen men with every swing. Icathians flew in pieces from their crackling blades, were crushed beneath their tread, or were rent asunder like bloody rags. "Back!" shouted Cyjax. "Back to the walls!" None could pierce the God Warrior's armor, and their ferocity was so primal, so inhuman, that it froze me to the spot. Spears snapped against their iron harsh hides, and the bellowing roars cut me to the marrow with terror. One, a cawing beast with the ragged, feathered wings and a vulture-like beak, leapt into the air, and searing blue fire blazed from its outstretched claws. I cried out at the sight of my fellow countrymen burned to ash. The elation that had, only moments before, filled us with thoughts of victory and glory, now shattered like fallen glass. In its place, I felt a sick horror of torments yet to come. The retribution of an unimaginably cruel despot who knows no mercy. I felt a hand grab my shoulder and lifted my bloody blade. "Move, Axa," said Cyjax, forcing me back. "There's still a fight to be done." I was dragged along by the force of his grip, barely able to keep my feet. I wept as we streamed back to where we had first formed up. Our line was broken, and surely the day was lost. But the God Warriors simply stood among the dead, not even bothering to pursue. "You said we had a weapon," I cried. "Why aren't they doing anything?" "They are," said Cyjax. "Look." What happened next defies my understanding. No mortal eye had ever seen such a thing. The pavilion exploded with forking traceries of light, arcing loops of purple energy ripped into the sky and lashing down like crashing waves. Force of the blast threw everyone to the ground. I covered my ears as a deafening scream tore the air. I pressed myself to the battle-churned earth as the wail burrowed deep into my skull, as though the world itself were shrieking in horror. I rolled onto my side, retching as stabbing nausea ripped through my belly. The sky, once bright and blue, was now the color of a week-old bruise. Unnatural twilight held sway, and I saw flickering afterimages burn themselves onto the back of my mind. Slashing claws, gapping maws, all-seeing eyes. I sobbed in terror at the sight of such horrors. Alone of all the things being stripped from me, this I gladly surrender. A nightmarish light, sickly blue and ugly purple, smothered the world, pressing down from above and blooming up from somewhere far below. I pushed myself upright, turning in a slow circle as the world ended around me. The Shuriemans were streaming back from the city, terrified by whatever force our priests had unleashed. My enemies were being destroyed, and I knew I should be triumphal, but this was not a victory any sane person could revel in. This was extinction. An abyss that bled purple light tore open amid the Shuriemans, and I saw the ivory-skinned general overcome by wiping cords of matter. She fought to free herself with the wide sweeps of her blade, but the power we had unleashed was too much for her. The pulsing, glowing light spread over her body like a hideous cocoon. Everywhere I looked, I saw the same slick coils rising from the earth, or from the very air itself, to seize the flesh of mortals. Men and women were swept up and enveloped. I saw one Shuriman clawing his way over the earth, his body seeming to dissolve as the tendrils of foul energy overwhelmed him. I began to hope, to pray that this doom was what had been planned all along. I saw shapes in the flickering light, too fast and indistinct to make out clearly, stretching swelling limbs of strange tar-like matter. Men were clawed from their feet and pulled apart. I heard the gurgling, hooting bellows of things never meant to walk the surface of this world. As awful as this day had become, I wondered if this was the price of the great weapon our priests had unleashed. I hardened my heart to the suffering of the Shuriemans and remembered the centuries of misery they had heaped upon us. Once again, I lost sight of Cyjax and Colgrim, but I no longer needed their presence to steady me. I had proven myself worthy of my grandsire's name, worthy of the brand on my arm. I was Kohari. The sky groaned and buckled, sounding like a vast sailcloth tearing in a storm. I turned and ran back to the city, joining up with other soldiers. I saw the same desperate, horrified looks on their faces I knew must be upon mine. Had we won? None of us knew. The Shuumans were gone, swallowed whole by the terror we had unleashed upon the world. I felt no regret, no remorse. My horror had given way to justification. I had lost my Nimcha blade somewhere in the frenzy of the battle, so I took my bow from my shoulder and pumped it to the sky. Ikathia! I yelled. Ikathia! The chant was taken up again by the soldiers around me, and we stood to watch the enemy finally overcome. The seething mass of matter that had consumed them lay like a shroud over the flesh it had consumed. Its surface was undulant, and swelling blisters of glistering matter burst open with frothing burst sacs that twisted and unfolded like newborn animals. I turned as I heard a deafening grinding of rock. Booming cracks echoed as more and more chasms tore the landscape open. I dropped to my knees as the earth shook and the worlds of Ikathia, fallen once and now rising again, were shattered by a groaning bass note that split the earth. Geysers of dust and smoke erupted from within the city. I saw men screaming, but could not hear them over the crash of falling rock and splitting earth. Towers and palaces that had stood since the first Mage King planted his star metal staff were swallowed whole by the ever widening chasms. Only rubble and shattered fragments remained, my beloved city reduced to a charred skeleton. Fire sped skyward, and the wails of my people were somehow magnified by the canyons of the city as I fell into the hideous doom below. Ikathia! I cried one last time. I saw a flash of movement and flinched as something flew through the air above me. I recognized the vulture-headed god warrior from earlier in the battle. Its flight was erratic, its limbs already partially ruined and unmade by the strange matter spilling from the rents in the earth. It flew towards the pavilion with desperate beats of its ravaged wings, and I knew I had to stop it. I ran towards the towering creature, knocking an obsidian-tipped arrow to my bow. The thing stumbled as it landed. Its legs were twisted and its back was alive with devouring tendrils. Feathers and skin slored from its head as it limped past the bodies of dead priests, whose own flesh bubbled and roiled with an internal motion. Fire built around the god warrior's hands, ready to burn the pavilion with the last of its power. Sijax had said the Sun Empire had more armies, and we would need our weapon intact if we were to defeat them. I drew back the bowstring, an obsidian arrow aimed at the god warrior. I loosed, and the arrow sped through, punching through the dissolving matter of its skull. The god warrior fell, and the fire faded from its hand. It rolled onto its side, the flesh falling from its bones. I saw threads of sinewy pallid matter forming beneath. The god warrior sensed my presence and turned its vulturine head to me. One of its eyes was milky and distended by growth of a strange fungus-like substance spreading across its skull. The other had my arrow protruding through it.
Do you even know what you have done, foolish Ikathian?
The blind god warrior managed, its voice a red growl of dissolving vocal charts. I sought to think of some powerful words, something to mark the moment I had killed a god warrior. All I could think of was the truth. We freed ourselves, I said.
You have opened a door to a place that should never be opened.
It is.
You have doomed us all.
Time for you to die, I said. The god warrior tried to laugh, but what came out was gurgling death rattle.
Die? No. What is to come will be far worse. It will be as if none of us ever existed.
I left the arrow embedded in the God Warrior's skull. Mine were limping back from the battle, bloodied and weary, with the same look of incredulous horror in their eyes. None of us truly understood what had happened, but the Shuriemans were dead, and that was enough. Wasn't it? We milled in confusion, none of us knowing what to say or do. The landscape before the city was twisting with unnatural motion, the flesh of the Shuriemen army utterly obscured by pale, coiling ropes of hideous matter. Its surface was darkening as I watched, splitting where it hardened like some form of carapace. Vicious ichors spilled out, and more I had the impression that this was just the beginning of something far worse. Light still spilled from the colossal rents torn in the ground, and alien sounds, a mix of shrieking, hissing, and crazed howls, echoed from far below. I could feel tremors rising up from the bolts of the earth like the slow grinding of bedrock that presages an earthquake. "What's down there?" said a man I didn't know. His arm was all but encased in a translucent caul that was slowly creeping its way up the side of his neck. I wonder if he even knew. "Sounds like a nest or a lair or something." I didn't know what hideous things lived down there, nor did I want to. I heard a voice call my name and looked up to see Syjax limping toward me. His face was a mask of blood, thanks to a jagged wound that ran from above his right eye to his jawline. I hadn't thought Syjax could bleed at all. "You're hurt," I said. "It's worse than it looks." "Is this the end?" I asked him. "For Ikathia, I fear it is," he replied, moving away to grab the bridle of a cavalryman's mount. The beast was skittish, but Syjax halted its reins and vaulted into the saddle. "I would have given everything to see the Shuriemans defeated," I murmured. "I fear we just did," said Syjax. "But we won. The Shuriemans are dead." "But I'm not sure that's the same thing," said Syjax. "Now, find a mount. We have to go." "Go? What are you talking about?" "Ikathia is doomed," he said. "You see that, don't you? Not just the city, but our land. Look around. That will be our fate too." I knew he was right, but the idea of simply riding away? I didn't know if I could. "Ikathia is my home," I said. "There is nothing left of Ikathia, or at least there won't be soon." He extended his hand to take mine, and I shook it. "Axa," he said, casting a glance back at the creeping horror. "There is no hope here." I shook my head and said, "I was born here and I will die here." "Then hold to who you are while you still can, lad," he said, and I felt the weight of his sadness and guilt. "It's all you have left." Syjax turned his mount and rode away. I never saw him again. My name is Aksamuk Vachoy Kohari Ikathor. I think Aksamuk was my grandsire's name. It has meaning, but I can no longer remember what. I wandered the ruins where a great city once stood. All that is left is an impossibly wide crater, rubble and a tear in the fabric of the world. I feel a terrible emptiness before me. Aksamuk was a king, I think. I do not remember where. Was it here? In this ruined, sunken city? I do not know what Var or Choi mean. Ikathor should have a meaning to me, but whatever it was is gone. There's a terrible void where my mind and memories once dwelled. My name is Aksamuk Vachoy Kuhari. Kuhari? What is that? There's a mark on my arm, a sword wrapped in a scroll. Is it a slave mark? Was I the property of a conqueror? I remember a girl with green eyes and an opal necklace. Who was she? Was she my wife? My sister? A daughter? I do not know, but I remember the smell of her flowers. My name is Aksamuk Vachoy. I repeated it over and over, holding on to it as if it can stave off this slow dissolution. I do not want to forget it. It is all I have left. My name is Aksamuk. I am being erased. I know this, but I do not know why or how. Something awful writhes within me. All that I am is unraveling. I am being undone. My name is... My name... My...